Okay, I'm not a public speaker, so I'm going to swear a lot. I hope you guys aren't offended. It's either that or I wet myself, and I really don't want to do that because these jeans are very comfortable. So my name is Brian Ewing. I'm an illustrator. I'm kind of more than that now. I'm a maker. I make things. I'm stealing that line from somebody else, but I kind of started out as an illustrator, but then I started doing other things. Like, I make toys now. Like, I have my own toy company and stuff like that. And I even publish other artists when I can, and they're not too difficult to deal with. But I started out as an illustrator, and I came to the American Academy of Art in 1992. So if that gives you guys any idea of how old I am, I'm older. But back then, like, illustration was a lot different. You know, we didn't, you know, it's always the, we didn't have it as good as you guys had. Well, we did, but it was also much easier because there weren't as many of us. You know, like now, you know, this would be like the whole school, you know, but this is just like a couple of classes, I'm sure. So I'm just going to talk about me because I'm really good at that. I'm just going to kind of talk about some of the good and the bad of being an illustrator and kind of what I went through. I never had even seen a lecture. Like, I saw one lecture here, and the guy was totally horrible, and I got in trouble because I started berating the guy, because he was just like, well, I do this fine art, and my wife pays all the bills, and I was like, this does nothing for us because we're all students, we all have to pay our own bills, and you're a really bad example. So I hope I'm not that. Like, I'm going to give you as realistic as I can of an example of kind of, you know, the struggle of being an artist, because it's not easy, you know, like, you could draw well, then you have to know the business end of it, and that's a whole other personality you have to have. It's not fun, but it's also exciting, and it's also necessary. So I'm just going to start out with, like, my influences, and like, some of them started a long time ago. Let's see, like, how do we do the... Nope, that's not it. Oh boy. I need an adult.
You're an adult.
All right, let's do stuff. Okay. So when I was a kid, I grew up in Milwaukee, Wisconsin, which is like 40 minutes away. I have to tell this to everybody because they get mad when I don't tell them. Jeffrey Dahmer ate two of my classmates when I was going to school, and we had the Milwaukee Art Museum, which is pretty awesome because we had a lot of booze money coming in from Pabst and all these other beer companies. The rich people that own these things bought a lot of art and then they donated to the art museum. We had every day for our senior year, we went to the art museum for like half the day and we just drew and we learned art history. And they had this print up and it just blew my mind. I didn't know what I was looking at. I thought I was looking at a modern day illustration, you know, but this had been done at the turn of the century, like the early 1900s, late 1800s. And it was kind of like my entrance into really wanting to be an artist and really wanting to know more about art rather than what was being produced for me during that time with like Image Comics, Jim Lee, Rob Liefeld, and all that crap that was coming out. I wanted to know more. So I started really looking into art history, but focusing on the stuff that I was interested in. And if you look at Art Nouveau and like the secession movement, which was after Art Nouveau, those are some of the first like illustrators that actually were working and they had their own magazines and they would like illustrate advertisements and stuff like that. And so I was learning about that when I was a teenager and that just kind of blew my mind. And it made me a huge nerd, you know, and I was stoked on it because I wanted to know more and more about illustration. You know, hopefully you guys get like a history of illustration here and it's not boring, but if you really like art, go check stuff out. Like, you guys are, you know, blocks away from the art museum. Like, I used to go there on my lunch breaks every day just because I couldn't afford to buy lunch and I could go in for free, so I would just learn the collection there. And there's so many things you guys can apply from art history and looking at art into your own styles. So yeah, I'm gonna ramble a lot about that. When I was growing up and going to high school, I also worked at a comic book store. So I was a huge nerd, because back then comics weren't cool. You just get beat up for it. Like if you skateboard, you get beat up for that. So I was all the above. and I really love comics, and the guys that I worked with would start showing me other artists. So this is Bernie Wrightson. And Bernie Wrightson was an artist, he's still alive, but he was doing this work in the 70s. And he was a comic artist, but doing illustration within comics. And seeing this stuff, and I didn't know about EC Comics, which he was influenced by, but seeing this stuff and reading interviews with him, I learned about his influences, and that taught me more about history, because he was influenced by Alphonse Mucha, and then he was influenced by EC Comics, and all these other artists like Franklin Booth or Joseph Clement Cole. Hopefully you guys have heard of them. If not, you suck. So while being a huge nerd, working at a comic book store, going to a high school of the arts where we didn't have sports, and you never got beat up, and it was weird. It was some utopia, except for the serial killer. I really just, you know, one day the newspaper came to our school and they're like, they interviewed a bunch of us and they're like, what do you want to be? I was like, I want to be an illustrator. And I was like 15. I didn't know what I was talking about. I didn't know what illustration was, other than I really love shitty heavy metal bands, shitty punk rock, and I love skateboarding, I love comics. And I just wanted to do something in that. I didn't want to be a musician because that's stupid. But I wanted to be an artist that drew for these musicians and did stuff that got me interested into all this stuff, into all these areas. I wanted to be one of those people that did that for other people. And that sounds cool. I didn't think of it that way. I'm looking at it in retrospect. I mean, like then I just like, I want to draw skulls. I want to draw like naked chicks. And I want to draw like cool shit. And I did not put that in the interview with the newspaper when I was 15. But that's what I want to do. And I had no idea to actually go and do it, which is kind of shocking to me and everybody else around me. I thought I'd be a janitor. So after like being influenced by comics, I kind of took that, like we had art history every day in high school, so when I took art history here, it was really easy and boring because I knew everything, so I just started really focusing on illustration, and I had one teacher here, his name was Warren Prindle, and he was a life drawing teacher, but we would just shit talk about illustration. So if you can find a teacher here that's going to kind of introduce you to art, let them, you know, because there were some teachers here that were really grumpy and you didn't want to talk to and you just were afraid of. But, and when you're 18, you're very kind of shy and scared of all this stuff, but that teacher is actually really cool to me, and he was a major influence on me for the rest of my life as to how I talk to other artists because of the way he treated me. But he also just showed me, like, hey, check this out. Look at this illustration. Let's talk about EC Comics for a bit. He'd bring stuff in and show it to me. It's really cool. And I would show him the stuff that I was into. So by the time I start going to school here, I started getting into rock posters, which was a bad idea. So I started seeing this stuff where they were taking illustration, but they were really fucking with it. I mean, look at it. He's got a penis, you know? And there's Tom shooting up. And you see this stuff, you're like, wow, this is awesome. Because they're taking all these icons, this canon, if you will, and they're just totally mixing it up and they're fucking with you. And they're turning something else out of it. You know, it's kind of like what you're going to hear Warhol a lot, just because he's still a famous modern artist. But they're doing what Warhol did. He took what people already knew and he presented to them in a different way. And that's kind of what was going on with rock posters for me. And when you're young, you love music, which is pretty obvious with you guys and your silly hair. But you know, you identify yourself with music. You know, that's really important. Seriously, it looks like you guys just got off the Warped Tour bus. It's hilarious. Or you're going to Hot Topic after this, I don't know. And I'm not really one to talk, so. You know, like, I assume most of you guys, like, identify yourselves with your passions, which would be music and art. And it's easier to identify yourself with music because it's more universally known. And I just loved music at the time, and after going to art school, I just I got a job at Kinko's, and I was just really getting into poster art and stuff like that. And this is Coop, and you know where you have, I'm gonna just talk and make sense once in a while, but you have Kozik, Frank Kozik, like he would take stuff, and he never considered himself an artist, but he would just do weird shit. Like he would stretch text, you never do that, but for some reason, because it's punk rock, you know, in the very literal sense, it works because it's for shitty punk rock bands. And they don't have much taste. So, but then you have people like Coop, who was also influenced by some of the people that I mentioned, like Alphonse Mucha and EC Comics and Mad Magazine. And he's taking, you know, he's working with the same types of bands, but then he's kind of like sexualizing it. You know, and that's advertising 101 is how do you get someone's attention. One way is to sexualize it. You know, there's a lot of innuendo, but there's no like money shot, all right? I'm gonna say it. And I can say that because I used to work in pornography for a couple of years, which I'll get to, because that's what happens when you become an illustrator. You just go down into that deep, dark alleyway and never come out. Until you find Jesus. Unless some of you are really religious, I hope not, because that would be a waste. Anyway, so these were kind of like my influences when I was starting out, you know, from like when I was a teenager till I was about your age, okay? And I was seeing people do art in a way that it didn't have to advertise Coca-Cola, you know? It wasn't a greeting card, or, you know, it wasn't for a video game. It was just, it was part of a culture, you know, which I didn't really understand. You know, this is like my love of punk rock and shitty metal bands and skateboarding and comics was kind of encapsulated all in rock posters. And so I kind of started going in that direction. So that's kind of like the, so that's kind of like some of my influences. And here's some of my current influences, which I currently live in Columbus, Ohio. Prior to that, I lived in New York City, not Brooklyn, because fuck those hipsters, but actually lived in Manhattan, you know, and I made sure, this was like my selfish promise to myself is, you know, I want to live there as an artist. I don't want to have a day job. I don't have parents to pay for anything, so I can't rely on that. I just wanted to do it as an artist and pay for everything. But the one thing about living in a city like New York, even like this, is all the artwork that's there. There's so much art and so many art galleries, and there's so much public art and so much street art that you're a fool to not be influenced by that, because it's free, it's beautiful, and it's current, you know, and that's, no matter what you do as an artist, you have to be current. Nobody wants someone who is into steampunk. Even though it's current, your audience and your dating pool is gonna be really tiny. While living in New York, I got to meet some artists there, which is kind of cool. That's the other thing about being an artist is, I have no personality. Like, I'm terrified of people. I don't want to talk to them. But as an artist, it opens doors for me, and it lets me meet some of the artists that I always wanted to meet, or that, you know, will be fortuitous for me because I'll find something in common with them. So I got to meet artists like Fail, who do like huge installations and art shows and all this crazy shit. Like, they did something for the New York Ballet, you know, but with this stuff, as, you know, as artists. You know, this is basically illustration. It's nothing, it's more Warhol, and it's illustration, it's printmaking. But they just do cool ass shit. And so they did a lot of public art that I would see everywhere in New York. And again, it's hard to not be influenced by that. And when you're coming up as an artist, you have all these influences, and you think you're just gonna keep them for the rest of your life, you're just gonna have one style, you're not. If you're smart, you're not, because you need to grow, okay? Like, there's a few artists who can pull it off, like Alex Ross. But if you look at Alex Ross's paintings, you sometimes see how bored he is because he can do it. It's not hard to him, you know. So sometimes his paintings are so good they're boring. So as an artist, you kind of have to like always be influenced, no matter what it is, whether it's fucking Skrillex, whether it's country music, whether it's, you know, hey, there's a lot of money in country music, whether it's NASCAR or anything. Like, you should never worry about where your influences are coming from or how they define you, because it's your job to not be like everybody else. It's your job to be different than everyone else, even the person next to you. So I started letting a lot of like art in New York kind of influence me, and I got to meet these people, and it became very personal for me, because it just kind of opened my eyes to things that I didn't know was possible. You know, like, I didn't go to school for printmaking, but, you know, I learned printmaking on my own, and then I saw people doing stuff with printmaking that I didn't know you could do. Like, these guys, Fail, what they would do is, I'm gonna screw this up again, I'm sure, but what these guys would do is they would screen print on these blocks, and then cut them, and then do all the different sides of the blocks and then just kind of like turn the blocks any way they want it. So they're taking illustration, they're making it into like fine art almost, and they're showing you something in a different way you've never seen before, and they're making stupid money for it. And you know, they're a lot of it's they're just taking, they're influenced by comic art. You know, you guys are influenced by comic art mostly. And other things, and they're taking that influence, but they're taking it in a different direction. Instead of drawing comics, they're kind of using comics as a way to express themselves and also kind of take a lot of money from rich people by doing fine art with it. You know, kind of like what Andy Warhol did. It's kind of a shitty thing to say, but that's, there's commerce in art, and you can't really ignore that. But like, this was for like the ballet. Like, how cool is that? There's an octopus, you know, dancing with a ballet dancer, and like, that's the kind of cool shit you could do as artists, you know? Like, if someone doesn't show you, you may never know, because we all look for role models, and you need to, like I said, you need to let yourself be influenced. Like, all this crazy installation stuff, after seeing that, I wanted to try it because I didn't know I could, and you should always treat art as, what can you get away with, you know? When I say art, I mean art. Like, Illustrator is your artist, no matter what. And whatever you want to do, you can do. No one's going to stop you but you. Or being broke. That always stops me. But, damn, I keep doing that. Stupid technology. And this is another artist. They're called Morning Breath. And it's a duo as well. And they're in New York, too. Come on, work. Okay. I don't know what I'm doing. Yep, see? I'm glad you guys are filming this.
It's a Mac.
What?
It's a Mac. It happens.
Hey, they're idiot-proof, usually. Better than PCs. All right, so I'm going to try this again. All right, so this is kind of the same thing. Like, these artists came up at the same time in New York, but they have similar styles that really influence each other. Like, they would look at comic books and be influenced by that stuff as well. But they were more illustrators. They actually drew their stuff and they printed everything. And like, you don't have to like the Foo Fighters, but they do all the packaging for them. And even though they're illustrators, they could still do graphic design and photography and film and stuff like that. And so I had an opportunity to hang out with them at their studio, and they just kind of like just showed me all this stuff. And it just, again, it just like really blew my mind. There are a million artists in Chicago. I see where you're going. Might be that way. There are a million artists in Chicago. If you can, hit them up, you know, like, it's not going to kill you if they say no, but if you have an opportunity, say, like, Chris Ware still lives in Chicago, right? A buddy of mine once, he lived in Milwaukee, and he's just like, hey, you know, I really like your work. 6 months later, he gets a postcard within it, you know, like a hand-drawn postcard. He's like, yeah, if you ever want to come down to my studio, come on down. I don't know who you are, but you don't seem like a terrorist, so come on down. So my friend just got to, like, go talk to him, and like I said, as artists, That's your ticket. That's your in to meet some of the people you always wanted to meet and talk to, and it gives you, you know, it gives you practice basically to be around other artists, to learn what kind of questions you were going to ask. Because I meet young artists all the time, and they ask me really stupid shit, and it's only because they really haven't had a chance to talk to a lot of artists. And sadly, I'm going to be there first. And one of the things that I didn't have the opportunity was communication when I was younger. You just couldn't email somebody when I was starting out. So unless you bumped into them on the street or you went to one of their shows, that was the only chance you got to talk to them. So when I actually had a chance, you know, when email was being used, finally, and I actually had a chance to talk to some of these artists that I really looked up to. I'd already been doing illustration for a couple years. So my form of questions were a little more elevated than they would have been a couple years ago. But I wish I had that practice. I wish I had the experience to meet somebody that's going to show me all this crazy shit you can do. I mean, school's going to show you only so much. It's not their job to make you fully formed artists. It's their job to get you started and then kick your ass out the door, and then a couple months later start asking for their money back. You know, I mean, that's basically, a school is just boot camp. The rest is up to you. So this is what these guys do, and they use a lot of collage and stuff like that. Kind of like Fail, but a little bit cleaner. But they do more commercial work, you know, like Mass Appeal being a magazine, but then they do paintings and stuff like that at galleries and whatnot. And they just do weird shit. They do stuff for like snowboards and skateboards and bands. So meeting them was kind of like a really cool experience. So that's kind of where like some of my influences are coming now, because as an artist, you do something long enough, you get bored, you know, and so you really need to inject new things, and that's what I was trying to do. I'm gonna burp. There we go. Hey man, can't stand it? So this is some of my early work. I'm not going to show you the early work, because that shit's embarrassing. This is kind of some of the stuff that I was doing in like the past 10 years. You know, some of the stuff that you guys saw hanging around was pieces I had just done a couple months ago for a show that I have here at Gallery F that's hanging up right now. And I did like a bunch of new pieces. And so it's kind of, I'm trying to take some of the stuff I used to do with some of the stuff that I do now and just kind of make another new thing to keep me interested. So this is some of the stuff that I used to do. A lot of the work I do is hand-drawn. So I use computers, but only for coloring and for pre-press, you know, basically just so I can make it as idiot-proof as I can for my client, because my clients are stupid. All your clients are stupid. That's why they hired you, because they're not creative and they don't know how to send things to a printer. You should. Basically, I did all the coloring in Illustrator. I inked everything by hand and then just kind of laid flat color down, and I used Illustrator like you can with Photoshop. I never took a class on how to use Photoshop or Illustrator, so I just kind of learned the idiot way by making lots of mistakes, which is probably the cheapest way to do it. This is one of these pieces that are going to haunt me for the rest of my life. This is for a band called Brand New, which are still around, and God, this is 11 years ago. Fuck. Seriously. When I did this piece, I was going through a really bad breakup, and lo and behold, I actually looked like this at one point. Now I'm much prettier. Thank you. When you do commercial work, there's nothing wrong with interjecting things that are going to make it interesting to you. Because, like, you could be illustrating the most realistic hamburger. That shit's boring. So how do you make it interesting? You know, besides getting paid is interesting, but still, you're just wasting your life away just trying to draw that glistening drop of water on a tomato. So how do you make it interesting? You've got to interject some of yourself into everything you do, whether it's like 5% or 90%. For this, I put 100% in. I was, oddly enough, I was living in LA, I was dating a girl in Chicago, and she sucked. Like, I would go and visit her all the time, she never came to visit me. And I felt like I was in this relationship and I was drowning. And I'd gotten hired by another shitty band called Static Lullaby. I don't even know how to pronounce it because they're so horrible. And they're like, yeah, man, we want you to do a poster for us. I'm like, all right, sweet. And this is where I kind of learned a little bit of business. When you work with a band, most of them have no creative decisions. Like, they have no creative power. So they just got signed to a major, and they're like, yeah, man, we want you to do this. We're going to pay you. I'm like, all right, cool. And they happen to be really good friends with that girl I was dating, so that's the only reason why I did it, so I could impress her with how much I hated being in a relationship with her. With this, I finished the artwork. They're like, we want, like, manta rays and, like, bullets, like, going into the water. I'm like, that's so stupid. So what I did was I did it on different layers so I could take it out in case they realized how dumb it was. I gave them the artwork, and they're like, yeah, you know, contact their manager, he'll pay you. So I contact the manager, and he's like, let me call you back. I was like, all right, cool. This guy also managed The Cure and all these other bands, and I'm like, this is going to be awesome. Totally getting paid. So he calls me back, he's like, Brian, I got some bad news for you. I'm like, I'm fucked, aren't I? He's like, yep. I was like, why? He's like, well, most bands, you should know, when you deal with them, they're really not in charge of hiring you. That's why they have managers. The managers are paid to do that for you. So when you talk to a band that's not a local band, like say if you're actually interested in this crap, you know, make sure you get to talk to their managers, because if you don't, you're gonna end up like I did, where you do all this work, and they're like, well, we'll do you a favor, we'll use the artwork. I'm like, how's that a favor to me? Like, well, you know, we'll put it on t-shirts. And I'm like, and who gets paid? Well, the band gets paid. And I was like, again, how's that a favor to me? He's like, well, and I was like, fuck you, I'm gone. A week later, this band called Brand New hit me up, never heard of them. And that's the other great thing about being a freelance artist is you're going to get clients that you've never heard of with things that you've never considered, and it's going to open up your worldview on things, whether it's music, politics, products, whatever. And so working with bands, I worked with a lot of bands I never ever would have gone out and bought an album, you know, or downloaded or anything. But when you have to work with them, you have to listen to their music. So when I listened to this band, I sent in all these sketches and they're like, yeah, we're not sure, we don't know. And so I just, I was listening to the music and I just grabbed the lyric and I just slapped it on this one. I was like, how about this? It's done. They're like, perfect. So I took out the manta rays and took out the bullet holes, and this piece ended up getting used on a tour. They made like this 20 by 20 foot backdrop of me, which is just retarded. And they made t-shirts and posters and all this stuff. And they had a huge fan base, and I got to ride the coattails of that. And that really catapulted me. Like, other people were doing rock posters at the time. Like, I want to say it's just me, but it wasn't, you know? There's like dozens of people doing it. We're all kind of like, we're kind of mildly mall walking. We're not really running a race against each other. But we're kind of all going in the same direction at the same time, at the same speed. And working with this client just kind of just like shot me past them. And it got me crazy amount of work after that. But what they did was, I got paid very little. I got like $500, but I said, I own the rights to the artwork. You're not gonna use it at the tour anyway, so you can use it for shirts, posters, and this stupid backdrop, go for it. But I own the rights to the artwork. So, the next tour, you know, their manager's like, hey man, you know, do us a solid and can you do like an EP cover for us? I'm like, yeah, sure. He's like, yeah, we only got like $200. I'm like, oh, fuck me. So I was like, all right, I'll do it. And then he's like, oh, can you do another poster for us? I'm like, yeah, sure. I was like, what kind of money are we talking? He's like, oh, we only got a couple $100. I was just like, why am I doing this? So I did the artwork and I turned it in. He's like, oh, you know what? We're going to go with somebody else. I was like, no, this job's mine. You owe me money. He's like, yeah, but this guy turned it in and he's not charging us, so we're just gonna go with him. It's not that it was any better, it's just that it was free. That's the other thing you're gonna learn about. Doing artwork for free is fun until you realize that the throat you're cutting is your own and the person next to you. Like, you're like, man, I just gotta get my foot in the door. It's totally gonna get me in. Then after that, I'm gonna charge. I'm gonna make money for this. You know, I'm not gonna be doing this for free. But then you're only gonna be, what really happens is you get to be known as the free person. They only call you when they want free work or cheap work. So I was like, you know what, dude? You can suck a dick. I am not. I'm sorry. This is, you know, this is the rock, this is the music industry, and it's on tape. But, you know, I was just like, no, man, you can't treat me like that. That's fucked up. I value what I do. You guys should value what I do. And I'm not asking for millions of dollars. So, I took the rights to the artwork back and I reprinted the shit out of it. And I've made thousands of dollars off of it because, you know, as artists, when you're young, you want to be accepted. You want people to like you, want to get hired. You kind of give away things, like I said, working for free. The other thing is like intellectual property. You know, if you're not drawing Batman or Mickey Mouse and you're coming up with something that's totally yours, you should own it, okay? Even if it's a fucking skull, as long as it's your skull and you drew it, you didn't copy another artist, and it's not already trademarked and copyrighted, it's yours, you own it. So enjoy it and license the shit out of it like I did. So that was kind of my revenge for the band. It was like, you know what, you guys tried to dick me over. I'm taking the artwork back. You've already used it, that's fine. You've already really put me out there. You've done more advertising for me than I can ever do. And I'm taking it back because your manager sucks. And I've made tons and tons of money off of it. And yes, being an artist is about making money sometimes, because unless you guys are rich or your parents never want you to move out, you gotta afford to be an artist, you know, and I don't want two jobs and then draw when I get home. So I do like getting paid. There's nothing wrong with that. So don't ever feel bad. Plus, this is a commercial arts school. I mean, you know, you guys are paying good money for it. You might as well make that money back so you can afford your student loans. Anyway, I digress. So yeah, I said I worked in porn. Any of you guys married? Good. Don't get married. Not that I've ever been married, but when you're starting as an artist, you're going to be very selfish, and you never ever want to make your loved ones suffer because of your selfishness. You should suffer, but not them. So don't get married. Don't have kids until you kind of get your shit together. You know, that's a kind of golden rule for anything. But anyway, I was living in Minneapolis. Started dating this girl. She's like, hey, I'm going to USC for graduate school. Come to LA. And I was like, never going to LA. So I moved to LA. And she proposed to me, we were going to get married, didn't work out, you know, sad story. But while I was in Minneapolis, I was working at Kinko's, and I was working there because I didn't know enough about printing, and I wanted to get a job that would teach me more about design and printing. I didn't even own a computer, but they paid me to learn how to use computers. So during my off time, I'd play, like, I don't know, fucking Doom, and then, and this was like dial-up, so it was just painful. But then I learned how to use like Photoshop and Illustrator and stuff like that. Then I learned how to get stuff printed and like teach myself design. So even if you guys stop going to school, whether you drop out or you graduate, don't stop learning. And if you're gonna get a shitty job, you know, because you are, get a shitty job that teaches you something that is actually gonna propel you to what you're doing. It's not hard. I mean, it's Kinko's. You know, I'm sure their benefit plan is probably awesome now. So anyway, I don't even know why I was talking about Kinko's. So I moved to LA, got a job at Kinko's there. I hated it because I just worked with all these idiots. And you know, you never want to be the king of the idiots. You don't want to be the smartest person in the room. You want to be the dumbest because you want to learn. So I saw this ad in the newspaper. It said, adult magazine looking for assistant art director. And when they said adult, I thought they meant like GQ or Details or Rolling Stone. So I applied and I told them I'm a art school dropout, and on the first day of school here, our teacher handed out truck driving applications, and I saved it. And so in my cover letter to this magazine, I said I was considering becoming a truck driver. So they called me up, and they're like, hey, we think you're hustler material. I was like, oh, what, hustler? You know, and I grew up in a really, really strictly Catholic family, as you can tell. And so I was pretty oblivious to all this stuff, and you know, my youth is different than your youth. We weren't as exposed to it as much. We weren't as desensitized either. So I started working at Hustler magazine. So I was a pornographer for about 2.5 years, and I got hired on a Tuesday, and I got fired on a Thursday that week because I went in, and the lady I talked to, I went in, like, I didn't know how to present myself. Like, seriously, guys, it's more than just taking a shower and wearing a clean shirt. It's how you present yourself. So I really didn't know how to present myself. I walked in with a manila envelope with black and white Xeroxes from Kinko's, you know, folded in half of all the flyers I had done, the posters. And I was also doing, like, shitty illustrations for, like, role-playing games, which I never played. Ironic. And I got the job, and we talked about the job for about 20 minutes. And I got the job because we talked about music for an hour. So this lady, she grew up in the 70s in New York, knew the Ramones and Blondie and all that. So we hit it off really well. Plus, I didn't freak out when there was all this nudity everywhere. So I get the job. I quit my job. I'm like, see ya. And because you guys suck. And I started working at Hustler. I didn't even get in the door, and they fired me. Because Larry Flint, who owns the magazine, if you guys haven't seen that really amazing movie, the R-rated one, not the one on the internet. That was a bad joke. Like, I saved myself somehow, though. So Larry Flint owned it, but he has tons and tons of family, and they're like, yeah, we had to fire you because one of his nephews wants a job, so we're going to make him an art director. And I was like, seriously? So a week later, I got a job. They found a new spot for me. I got to design the 1-800 number ads you'd see at the backs of magazines, which none of you have, I could tell. No, nobody. All right. So yeah, I started designing. Like, I really didn't know how to use Quark Express, which you guys probably never heard of. But nowadays you have InDesign. But I was teaching myself Quark Express because I lied. You know, like, do you know how to use this? I'm like, totally. Just give me the job. So I was teaching myself how to use programs while I was on the job laying out porno ads, which was kind of funny. So after a couple of years there, I really didn't advance and I really hated it. This is a really long story. I quit, and my fiance at the time was like, don't quit. I was like, why? She's like, you'll never make it as an artist. I'm like, oh, okay. Thank you, good to know. So I quit anyway. I had like $500 in my pocket, rent was due, and I had a really pissed off girlfriend. So over the weekend, what I did was I contacted everybody. Like, I was kind of doing posters, but not many. And but I made my own website, at work, of course, on their dime. And I made my own website, and I just started contacting everybody. And I got one job, which was this. This was for a punk rock label called BYO. And it was for a compilation album that I still see in record stores, which kind of makes me laugh, because, you know, I got like $500 that totally covered my rent. But what I did was, I emailed like 250 art directors, editors, bands, agents, promoters, whatever I could find on the internet at the time. And I contacted them all, and I got one job out of it. So I finished the job, and I contacted the other 249 right after. I'd said, I just got this job, I just finished it, it's for this company. And then I got another job after that. And I just kept doing that, and I was getting work, only because I was persistent. You know, like, you're gonna get turned down all the time, no matter what. No matter if your art's good, there just may not be a job for you at the time. Or you might suck, but you have potential, which was my case. And so I used every job I had as a victory. You know, like, you shouldn't hold out for that big paying job that's gonna pay you $80,000. If that job that paid you $500 paid you, and you have something out there that's in print and shows that you can actually meet a deadline, someone took a chance on you and you didn't fuck it up, you should treat that as a victory and just show that to people. Never be ashamed of what you do unless you don't like what you do, and then you have a problem, because you should never, like, if you don't like what you do, other people can tell. So whenever you show your portfolio, don't ever talk, you know, because people do that all the time. They're like, yeah, this is my best piece. When people show me their work, I'm like, shut up, I don't want to hear you. If I have a question, you're going to answer it. Otherwise, just let me flip through this. Because if I could actually hire you, thankfully I can't, I wouldn't hire you, because you won't shut up and you don't have any confidence in what you do. So yeah, pornography, Kinko's, first job. So after that, I started doing posters for bands, and there's a local venue called the Troubadour, right? Which is pretty, kind of a big deal. And I just said, hey, I used to do flyers in Minneapolis, can I do flyers for you? And they're like, yeah, sure. And so I started doing posters for them, and bands would start going, hey, we saw that Coheed and Cambria had a poster made for them, do we get one? And the Troubadour would be like, hey, Brian, do you want to do another poster? I was like, fuck yeah. And I was getting paid with like drink tickets and like guest list to the shows. And then people would email me like, hey, can I buy this? And I'm like, wait, I can make money doing this? All right, let's figure this out. So I talked to the venue, and I talked to the bands. I was like, are you guys cool if you get copies that I also sell copies? They're like, sure. So, you know, being an artist is all about what you can get away with, so don't be afraid to ask for things, even if it sounds ridiculous. I once got a refrigerator from a client because I asked. Seriously, it was for Red Bull, and they're like, anything you want? I'm like, yeah, I want a pallet of Red Bull, and I want one of those cool refrigerators in case UMTV Cribs comes over. And I got a refrigerator, which I never used because it was kind of useless. But if I didn't ask for the permission to do this, I wouldn't have done it, and I wouldn't have taken, you know, like, when I quit Hustler, I was making as much money doing posters then as I was as a pornographer and hating it. So I was like, I got nothing to lose, and worse comes worse, I get another job outside of pornography, of course, because then my mom would be proud. That's a story, but I can't tell you. So I started doing posters, I asked for permission, and then bands started coming in, and they're like, yeah, we want Brian to do stuff for us. So I started getting a reputation, and I started using the Troubadour as my office at night, and I would go to these shows for free, and I wouldn't drink. That's one thing, like, if you ever meet with a client at a bar, don't drink. Even if, like, seriously, because at the end of the night, you're going to be like, you think they're your best friend. You're going to be like, oh yeah, man, I'll totally do this for free. I learned that the hard way. So, you know, people are always offering you stuff, and it's like a t-shirt, take it, you know, but if it's a drink, don't really do it. So I would just treat the Troubadour as my office, and I would just talk to bands all the time. I really didn't care about bands. I mean, I love music, but I didn't want an autograph, and I didn't want a photo. And it showed also that I wasn't there to, like, as a fan, that I was there as a professional. Like, it's really important to act professional when you need to. This is one of the pieces that I did that I was actually happy with that kind of got me out there. Elliot Smith, too, like, this is one of the very few first posters I did, and this is when I was living in Minneapolis, just kind of learning about design. Here I'm using the Kozik method of stretching text to fill up a space. Bad idea. That's the early stuff. And to make it interesting, if anybody has any questions while I'm talking, raise your hand. You know, because it'll either that or you have to listen to me brag, and it's really boring.
How do you advertise yourself?
What?
How do you advertise yourself?
Doing it right now. I have a website. You know, I have the standard thing that you're supposed to have, which that's awesome.
I mean, before the internet.
Oh, before the internet? I was lucky enough that it had just started. You know, it was in the 90s, and you used Dreamweaver, and it took like 20 minutes to load your page, but you had a website. So again, though, I learned how to make business cards at Kinko's, and I would use their color copiers for free and just run free shit all the time. I would make samples, I'd make postcards, and I'd kind of do the standard that everybody was doing at the time. Because I didn't know any better. I'm young, and I'm allowed to learn and to be ignorant, you know, which you guys are as well. So start out with what they're telling you to do, and then I started looking at other artists and seeing how they advertise themselves. I didn't want to be like them. I didn't want to draw like them. But I definitely appreciated the way they did business. So I looked at the way they set up their business, and I took cues from that. You know, I didn't want to be Shepard Fairey, but I liked the way he does business. So I would look at how he does it. And you just kind of like backwards, you know, you kind of dissect it. You backwards engineer, like, this is where I want to be. How do I get to that point? Where do I start to get to this? So back then, that's how I would do it. I would do comic conventions, which I still do. Back then I had like a shitty artist table that cost like $50, and you have your like three prints, and you make like, you know, $60, you know, you made $10 over what you spent. But you just start small, and that's the other thing, don't start big, because, you know, unless you're that prodigy that, you know, graduates from the school and is that one, you know, you're the Michael Jordan of the school. Because everybody here thinks they're going to be Michael Jordan, but they're not. There's only going to be one, and probably not you. Not me, not her, not, you know, whatever. But, don't overextend yourself financially as an artist in the beginning. Like, you don't need a brand new car, you don't need brand new this, that, you don't even need brand new equipment, you just need to get things going, and then you slowly just kind of build on that. Because if you try to buy everything at once, you have to then pay it all off. Whether it's with your soul or with your checkbook, you gotta pay all that off, you know? Also, you don't know what you're doing anyway, so why spend all that money on a nice car if you're gonna crash it, you know? And that's kind of what your career is. It's a car. It depends on how much money you want to put into it. Like in the beginning, I didn't put a lot into it. It was a shit box. It had a rusted hole in the floor of the car. It was cold in the winter. There was no heat. They only got AM stations. But you know, I started, and from there you just kind of build on that. Then you get like, all right, I'm gonna get nice seats, and I'm gonna take care of this rust, and I'm gonna get a real stereo. And that's kind of how I built my career. I just kind of did it a piece at a time, and that doesn't change for artists. Again, unless you're rich and you don't really need the jobs and you have like this crazy, you know, rich parent thing going on, you should start small. Don't ever start big. Don't ever spend, you know, thousands of dollars on a printer that you're never gonna make any money back on. You know, you don't need a brand new $2,000 scanner until you're actually at a point where you can afford it and you're actually using it enough that everything you do is making you that money back. I hope that makes sense. Any other questions before I start rambling again? No? All right. I had to pick some favorite posters. Like, I'd never done a lecture before. Do you guys know who Tomer Hanuka is? All right, well, when I was in New York, he lived a couple blocks away, and I was afraid of him. Not that, like, I thought he was gonna beat me up, but I was just like, oh my God, it's Tomer Hanuka, man. That guy is awesome. He uses pink and green in the most weird way, and it works. How does he do it? Well, I got to meet him because his web designer is my web designer. So the guy's like, yo, I'm gonna be in town, do you wanna hang out with Tomer? I'm like, yeah, okay. And so I'm all like, sup, Tomer, how's it going, man? You know, I'm trying to like be cool about it, I'm just like sweating bullets. And, but I remained professional, you know, like, I didn't say much because if I did, my voice would crack and I'd say something really stupid. But I knew who I was talking to. I did my research before I talked to him. And we just got coffee, we just kind of hung out. And then the next day he's like, hey, do you want to lecture at SVA? And I'm like, Tomer, I don't want to disappoint you, but I've never seen a lecture really. And the one I did see sucked and I got kicked out of the class. And he told me, you know, basically I'm giving you the formula that he uses for lecturing. He's like, just do this. Create some folders, put some shit in there, you know, and one of them's gonna be your favorite work. So I'm gonna show you some of that right now. And it's kind of hard to pick a favorite work because if you actually do have favorite pieces, you need to stop. because as an artist, you're constantly chasing something that doesn't exist, and that's perfection. And if you think you've done it, then go be a plumber, because that might be more satisfying. But I like the idea of kind of chasing this id, this thing that it looks like everybody else achieved, but me, you know? And they're looking at me going, man, Brian did it, but I didn't. You know, and they're looking at everybody else thinking the same thing I'm thinking, but they're applying it to someone else. So these are some pieces I don't hate, you know, where I feel like I've kind of made strides. I drew boobs, that was fun. Actually, there was more to it, but I censored it, not for you guys, but just in general, because my buddies put out this magazine called Royal Flush. It was this really illustrator-heavy magazine. It was awesome. And it was me and Paul Pope. Do you know who he is? So he's a comic artist. He does this thing called THB, and what's that hero thing he's doing? Yes.
Yes.
That exactly. We know what we're talking about. Nobody else matters. and he's a hero of mine too, because he does comics in a different way, in a more artistic way, and he's kind of like a rock star, and he looks like he never showers, as compared to all the nerdy comic artists that I would see in me. But we had to do the centerfold for the Hugh Hefner issue, which was just kind of like celebrating Hugh Hefner's as a publisher, and he used to actually publish comics, and he used to write comics, so that's what the article is really about. But they wanted us to do these centerfolds. Well, Paul Pope's centerfold and my centerfold got the magazine banned in most stores across the country. So that was kind of an achievement. I was pretty proud of that. You know, I didn't make any money on it, but I've always focused on the jobs I had to do. I never really did a lot of personal work. So when I got to do something I wanted to do, I was kind of lost. But then when I kind of figured it out, I was really gonna try new shit. You know, like I normally don't draw women, not because I don't want to, I just feel like I'm not good enough. And so I was like, all right, one thing I need to be better at is drawing hair. You know, like, I suck at drawing hair. So I just spent a lot of time looking at my influences and buying hair fashion magazines, which is really awkward at the store. You know, I felt like I had to get like a Guns and Ammo or something, or, you know, or like some Men's Fitness, just be like, what's up? But no, you know, I got like that and some like Vogue magazines and whatever. Yeah, I don't even know where I was going at. But, you know, what I do is I got better at drawing hair with this piece, and that made me really happy. And I was also learning how to do more color and use color better, and just I was learning how to use Illustrator in a different way that no one had taught me. So that's why I like this piece. And she's naked. This was fun to do because the publisher, they said you can only use two colors. You know, I was like, okay, how do I use two colors in a way that I can get the most out of this? You know, my medium is mostly screen printing, but it starts out as a drawing. In the middle, it's a file on my computer, but in the end, it's printed in a screen print fashion. It could be printed offset or whatever, it doesn't really matter. But so these were being screen printed, so I had to figure out a way to utilize screen printing in a different way than most people do. And so I treat it like a comic book. Most of you guys read comic books. So like with this stuff, everything was drawn in black and white, but then I went in and I created two layers. One layer, I erased all the outlines. Anything that's in black in this, I erased. And everything that's blue, I kept. And so what I was doing was, they call them color holds in comic coloring jargon. Anyway, no one cares. So that's what I did with that. And I was just really happy because, again, I was obsessed with drawing really good hair. And a bird. I really want to draw a bird. So that's what I did. I didn't screw that up. So this is kind of like what I've been doing for the past couple years. It's totally different than where I started. And that's kind of where I was saying, like, you gotta grow. You know, you're not done growing once you finish school. You're always gonna grow. And if you don't, you're gonna start to hate being an artist, and you're gonna resent it. I have friends who do resent it because they're just not growing as artists, and they kind of, no one can tell them where to go, and they're looking for that. I was looking for that. And when I was living in New York, I felt really lost. I wasn't getting as much work, and when I wasn't getting paid as much. And I was drawing twice as hard as I could just to pay the exorbitant amount of being there. So eventually I moved out, and I moved to Columbus, Ohio, because some friends talked me into it, and I really hate them for it, because Columbus is boring. Which, you know, if you guys have come from a small town, you understand. The food sucks. Like, they don't even have Dunkin' Donuts. It's sad. Like, I got really excited because I got to have a donut today in months. But it gave me a chance to kind of go, okay, I've been talking about drawing as an artist. Like, I actually have to do this. And so I got the opportunity when this band called the Melvins, I don't know if you guys, I don't know your vocabulary with music, but they're kind of like, if you like Nirvana, Nirvana cited them as an influence. And they're either very listenable or really awful. It's your choice. But they're a pretty heavy band, you know. But they're a very creative and artistic band. And oddly enough, I worked with the singer's wife at Hustler. She was the art director for Barely Legal, which is weird. So years later, you know, 10 years later, they hit me up. They're like, we got no money, but we want you to do a poster for us because we're the fucking Melvins, and we're big, and we're huge, and all that stuff. And I'm like, oh my god, this sucks. So I had to figure out a way to, like, make it work, you know. And the great thing about doing posters, usually, is you don't have an art director, which is kind of what you strive for as an artist, is not being told what to do and being able to just express yourself. And I, at the time, was just collecting old photos of monsters, just because I liked it and looked good in my apartment and whatever, you know. And so one day I scanned one and I just kind of drew on it with a Sharpie. I was just kind of writing out Melvins, because I was going to draw the photo and I was like, man, I don't want to draw a photo, that's fucking lame. But I took the silver Sharpie and I was just kind of drawing it. And then I just started drawing like a skeleton. I was like, well, what if I drew on top of it, you know? And so I was able to make it very affordable product for a client who had no money. And the other shitty part of this business plan is I had to pay for the printing, so I had to make it as cheap as possible. So I did it thinking, I'm screwed. Like, I totally fucked this up. No one's gonna like it, and I'm gonna be $800 in the hole, and I'm not gonna pay my rent. It took off. It sold out like in an hour. Most of my stuff prior to that didn't, and I was just kind of like shocked and happy and kind of scared, like, oh god, I gotta do this again. And so I started doing that again. You know, I just kind of, sadly, as an artist, you want every piece you do, you want to be different. That's what you want, but it doesn't mean that's what the public wants. You know, like, think of yourself as a consumer. You buy the same shit all the time by the same people because you're familiar with it and it's comfortable. And that's kind of what was happening. People were very familiar with what I was doing, very comfortable, and they wanted that. So I was like, fuck it, I'm doing it. And so for the past couple years, that's kind of what I've been doing. Some of the stuff you guys saw around the school is, like, this is the first piece I did like this, and where I'm at now is what you're seeing hanging up. So that's kind of like where I'm at with my style, my art, and all that crap, is I let myself be influenced, and I, you know, kind of, you know, necessity is the mother of invention. So is freaking out, you know, so is panicking, and so is being broke. So when you're broke, you gotta come up with creative ways to not be broke. You have to come up with creative ways to get something done for the least amount of money and still make money doing that. That's your job as an artist, no matter what. If you're doing greeting cards, or if you're doing fine art, or if you're drawing comics, you have to come up with ways to do things really fucking cheap, because no one values you as much as you do, and it's sad. You know, once you get out of here, you know, maybe you're gonna get the pep talk of like, all right, guys, you're artists, you're gonna fucking make it, you're gonna destroy the world, and you're gonna get out there and you're gonna be like, I can't get a job. I can't even get arrested as an artist. So it is true, you know, like, unless you're that Michael Jordan, you know, you're gonna be struggling. So the other thing, I'm gonna kind of backtrack because it's what they pay me to do, is I couldn't get a job as an artist, you know, when I was working at Hustler. I mean, I did illustrations for them that you'll never see, you know, because they paid well, but they're really not cool. I mean, I guess they would be, but, you know, whatever. But they couldn't give me real work outside of pornography, and I didn't want to go down that road, really. So I made my own job up. So I started, that's where rock posters came in. No one was, in my city was really doing them, and there wasn't really a need, but I found enough people that liked them, and so when nobody was hiring me, I just did it myself. I made my own job. That's what you guys can do. You know, like, fuck it. You're out, you know, and you're just not getting any work. You know, there's this magical thing called Etsy. Etsy's retarded. Don't even go down that rabbit hole, but it'll inspire you to kind of like make things, you know, and put value in what you do, and learn how to run a business. So when I kind of made up this job of rock posters for myself, I also had to learn how to run a business. I learned about printing. I learned about invoicing. All this stuff I never learned because I dropped out. And I'm not here to tell you not to drop out. Actually, I'd say drop out now. Save yourselves some fucking money. You know, because you guys are paid, what, $18,000, $19,000 a semester? Or $14,000? I don't know. It all sounds expensive. You know, if you took that money in those 4 years, you know, that's a lot of money, isn't it? You could invest a quarter of that into a business and probably be further along than you will when you graduate. But that's just me. You know, I probably wouldn't have gotten very far if I wasn't passionate. You know, if I just thought, like, if I go to art school and they'll just make me an artist, I'm gonna have to try. You know, I wouldn't have gotten very far. But because I really wanted to be an artist outside of not being able to afford art school, I wish I got kicked out. Like, that would have been awesome. I'd be like, fuck this, man. You know, throwing chairs and shit, and then like, oh, I'm such a rebel. I'm not. I was just a poor kid who couldn't afford to go here, you know. And I got nothing against you guys. I'm stoked that you guys can afford it. So while you're here, you better enjoy it, because people like me couldn't afford it. And we saw people like, oh, that sounds awful too, but you guys have a great opportunity. You can afford it so far. You need to take advantage of it, you know. And if you really feel school's not for you, leave. You know, no one's keeping you here. You know, except for this guilt that you have inside your head of like, oh my God, if I drop out of school, then I dropped out of life, and then I'm a loser, and then everybody's gonna think I'm a loser, and I'm gonna never become an artist, and I will become a janitor, which I did for a while after I dropped out of school, which was really weird. It was in a morgue at a hospital, and it was freaky. But don't ever do that either, but it paid well. So yeah. I couldn't find a job, so I made a job up for myself. And sometimes you guys have to be that creative. You can't just be clever and come up with a new catchphrase or a new image that's just going to get fucking tumblered, you know, to infinity. You actually, you know, take what you do seriously. And you're no longer a person. You're an identity. You're a brand. What's your name?
Tyler.
Tyler, you're a brand. So, you know, I crowned thee a brand. But no, like when you get out, you know, you're a business now. You're not a, you know, I always get made fun of for this. Jay-Z has this great quote, and it's a Kanye West song, but it's appropriate because he went here. But he's like, I'm not a businessman, I'm a businessman. You know, like, I'm a business. I'm not part of the business, I am a business. And that's what all you guys are. You're all individual businesses. You kind of have to treat it that way, you know, like, God, I really want to go off on this huge tangent, but, you know, like, I treat all my social media professionally. You don't know what I ate. I didn't even post an image of a donut, which I really wanted to. You don't know who I'm dating. You don't know whose relative died. You don't know any of that stuff because it's not important. You know, like, I see artists out there that they want to be famous. That's different than being a brand, okay? You can be famous and broke, or you can be famous and an asshole and nobody wants to hire you. And I see a lot of that. I see people who are really good who complain about their clients online. Don't ever do that. Don't ever talk about your ex-girlfriend or ex-boyfriend. Don't even be political unless that's part of who you are and that's part of your style and that's part of your business. You know, like, that's really important to how you present yourself. Like I said, you can be artists, but then you have to be business people too. You have to be a brand. So you're Tyler Incorporated. So from here on out, you know, anything you post should be work-related. If it's a sketch, if it's your grades, whatever, or if it's an artist you met or an art show you went to, post that stuff. Make yourself interesting. You know, because everybody eats, everybody breaks up, everybody has a relative that dies, everybody has a pet that's cute. Nobody cares. So don't waste your time with all that crap. Just when you're artist now, like, you have this title, you know, and it's kind of funny, but you need to actually take it serious. You know, you can't just be like, I'm an artist, you know, wear like a fucking scarf and drink cappuccinos and shit, read bad poetry, as people do. You know, you actually have to take it serious. You know, and if you don't like certain people, don't talk about it. You know, if you don't like a certain client, shut up. I have clients I don't like, but I never talk about them because they have money and I like their money. And their money pays my bills. Their money pays for these jeans or, you know, this coffee, and that's what's important to me. You know, I get satisfaction from drawing, but then I get to live off drawing as well. So be professional. You know, like, no matter how shitty of a mood you're in, how terrible a client's treated you, shut up. Don't ever, ever, ever post stuff about that, because I see it all the time and it just burns me. So even though I was pissed at the Melvins for not paying me, I made my money back, and then I, because of necessity, I was able to create a new style that's kind of making me a little bit of money right now.